In this section of the Power Mux Deep Dive, we'll be discussing design recommendations, specifically schematic and layout recommendations. To begin, let's discuss some recommendations we have for your schematic to ensure your design performs as expected. As the first step to creating your schematic, always refer to the truth table for the Power Mux you've selected. For example, here's the truth table for the TPS 2116 Power Mux. Once you've looked at the truth table for your desired device, it is important to decide whether you would like to perform an automatic or manual switching technique with your Power Mux device. As described in the first module of the deep dive, automatic switching will reference the input voltages to keep the device autonomous, whereas manual switching controls the power pass with an external GPIO control. Now let's say you were to select an automatic switching configuration. Using the information in the truth table, a schematic for the TPS 2116 can be created as shown with the information that the mode pin needs to be pulled to VN1 and the PR1 pins need to be controlled by VN1 through a resistor divider. Now that we know how to set up the TPS 2116 into an automatic switchover configuration, let's discuss how to determine the switchover point. As we know, VN1 needs to be connected to PR1 through a voltage divider. The PR1 pin voltage is then fed into a comparator, comparing the PR1 voltage against a constant VREF voltage. Checking the VREF value in the datasheet, we know this to be a typical 1 volt. Now, using the voltage divider equation on the upper right hand of this slide, we can substitute VPR1 for 1 volt and see the device will switch over once VN1 is less than R1 plus R2 all over R2. If instead manual switching is required, a look at the TPS 2116 truth table will lead to the following schematic. Knowing mode must be tied either to an external low or an external high bias. Taking a closer look at the truth table, we see that a high greater than 1 volt bias on the mode pin, as shown, will tell the device to look at the PR1 pin to decide which input to output. If the mode is tied low, then the device will operate in an ORing configuration where the larger supply is selected. With mode pulled high, a high PR1 voltage will select VN1, whereas a low PR1 voltage will select VN2, as long as the input is valid, greater than 1.6 volts. With mode pulled low, the greater supply is chosen, unless PR1 is pulled high, in which case the device will not select either input and the Power Mux will output high Z. Now, let's take a look at a different truth table. This one is for the TPS 2121. Let's begin with V-comp mode. In V-comp mode, by pulling PR1 and CP2 to ground, the device is put in an ORing configuration where the device selects the larger input to power the output. In VREF mode, by manually pulling PR1 and CP2 high when needed, the device will associate a high PR1 with an N1 selection and a high CP2 with a N2 selection. Lastly, our more popular mode is X-comp mode. This allows the device to operate autonomously by tying PR1 and CP2 to VN1 and VN2 respectively. The evaluation of PR1 to CP2 then decides which input is selected. Now let's discuss the X-comp mode in more detail. Now the X-comp mode is our most popular mode of operation, where the device can operate autonomously using VN1 and VN2 as voltage references for PR1 and CP2, respectively. Notice in the top right of the schematic. Once this mode is selected, let's discuss how to calculate the correct switchover based on these two voltage divisions. Because the device will switch over when the voltage on PR1 is greater than the voltage on CP2, we need to calculate the voltage division on both nodes and isolate VN1. This equation will help you solve for the correct switchover point between VN1 and VN2. Something to consider in this mode is if you have unstable input voltages and/or a strong load, is to consider adding hysteresis. Because these PR1 and CP2 equations have a direct relation to VN1 and VN2, we know the device is always responding to its inputs. When one device switches from another, the unselected supply will slightly rise in voltage as it is unloaded, and the loaded supply will slightly drop in voltage. As we know in a break before make configuration, when the device switches from one source to the other, it disconnects from both input paths to ensure there is no reverse current flow. The PR1 and CP2 comparator is quite sensitive, so if the input voltages are not stable, the PR1-CP2 comparison will occur over and over again. This results in a situation where the device keeps switching between the inputs. This is because during fast switchover, there is no soft start or current clamping. So if your output capacitance is quite large, or if your input voltage is not stable, you could have an inrush which will flow through the device and could cause the input voltage to dip noticeably. The decision to include hysteresis is very application specific, depending on many things, including your input capacitance, strength of your supply, and the strength of your load. If needed, hysteresis can be used to add a buffer between the switchover from N1 to N2 to the switchover back to N1. To add this buffer, the ST pin can be used. This pin pulls to ground when N2 is selected. Therefore, by connecting a resistor between ST and PR1, a parallel resistance is added to the path between PR1 and ground, pulling PR1 further down when N2 is selected. Boxed is the criteria to switch back to VN1 after VN2 is selected. By pulling PR1 further low, this design adds a buffer to the switchback to VN1. The last section to cover in the TPS2121 datasheet is the mode of operation where the device detects invalid inputs. In this case, overvoltage pins are used to determine whether the input voltage provided is outside of a user set value. To set this value, the overvoltage pins are tied to the input voltages through a voltage division. Each overvoltage pin voltage is compared internally with a constant VREF. Once the node is greater than or equal to VREF, the input is marked invalid until the overvoltage pin falls below VREF. To set what resistor values are needed for the desired overvoltage, the following equation can be used. Overvoltage pins can additionally be externally triggered using an MCU to pull the pin high to manually trigger one or both of the supplies invalid. In this video, we have covered how to select your switchover point, how to add hysteresis if needed, and how to implement overvoltage protection. In addition to this collateral, we provide a design calculator available on E2E using the link below this video. Here is how this Excel calculator will appear. The user is able to input their external resistor configurations and determine their switchover point from N1 to N2, their switchover point from N2 to N1 when using hysteresis, their overvoltage calculation, and current limit. Once you have completed your schematic with one of TI's PowerMux, next is to lay it out. We recommend the following when designing the layout for our PowerMux devices. High power paths should always have polygon pore planes to allow for current flow and heat dissipation. For high current applications, place vias under input and output pins to avoid current density and thermal resistance bottlenecks. We recommend input and output capacitors to be located close to VIN and VOUT pins to reduce the amount of parasitic inductance and minimize current loops. Increases in copper thickness will allow an increase in the device's ability to dissipate heat. Increasing board area, however, eventually results in diminishing returns as the bottleneck becomes the device's resistance. In this video, we've discussed design recommendations for a TI PowerMux. For more information on TI Power Muxes, please visit ti.com/powermux. And for more information on how to design your next power design, check out our 11 Ways to Protect Your Power Path ebook, which serves as a great resource in identifying what protection is needed for your system.